There are some events in Super Mario World that are not consistent and seem to have no predictable pattern to the outside observer. These events are said to be luck-based. Examples of these are subpixels, speed oscillation, and RNG. It is important to clarify that random number generation, or RNG, is a subset of luck-based events, and that not all luck-based events are driven by RNG. This video will focus only on this subset. In software and computing, RNG is used to make events act random. However, the algorithm that generates these numbers is just another piece of code, so the outcome is consistent and predictable if you look hard enough. Super Mario World has 4 bytes in memory that relate to the RNG output. They are address 148B through address 148E. The first 2 bytes can be seen as the seeds, which are used to create the second 2 bytes, which are the actual output of the RNG routine. When a sprite needs to make a random action, it calls the RNG routine, which uses the current seeds to update the output and create new seeds for the next call. The sprite can then use these 2 values to decide what action to take. If it needs more than 2 bytes of randomness, it can call the routine as many times as it needs. The RNG routine is actually very simple. Super Mario World uses a relatively small amount of randomness, so this routine fits the need well. This is the actual RNG routine, located at address 01ACF9 in the ROM. First, I'll explain this algorithm explicitly in assembly terms, and then I'll provide a simpler walkthrough. But first, you should know what the ASL, BIT, and EOR instructions do. ASL stands for Arithmetic Shift Left, and will shift the bits of the operand one space to the left, effectively doubling the number contained in the register. The bit that was shifted out the left side goes into the carry flag. BIT stands for Bit Test, and will set the Z flag in the processor if the accumulator and the operator equals 0. AND sets each bit of the result if the corresponding bits of both of the operands are set. EOR stands for Exclusive OR, and will set each bit of the result if the corresponding bits of each of the operands are different. You can also think of EOR as flipping the bits of operand 1 where the bits in operand 2 are set. The registers used in this routine are our RNG bytes, address 148B through 148E, the index register Y, and the accumulator A. The processor flags C and Z are used as well. Suppose these are our 4 bytes prior to the RNG call. Now I'll step through the routine to see how this affects the output. In the first part of the routine, we see that we load 1 into Y, call a subroutine, decrement Y to 0, call that same subroutine again, and then return. This is because for each of the 2 output bytes, the same seed bytes are used in succession. I'll only cover this subroutine once, but do know that it is called twice for each of the 2 output bytes. First, we load address 148B into A and shift it left twice. We set the carry flag and then add 148B plus the carry into our result. We store A back into address 148B, overwriting it. Then, we shift address 148C left once in place. The bit that was shifted out gets placed into the carry flag. Load the constant 20 into A and bit test it with address 148C. The Z flag will get updated with this test instruction. Then, depending on the states of the C and Z flags, we may or may not increment address 148C in place. In this case, we don't. All of the flow paths merge on this instruction, where we load the new value of address 148C into A. Then we exclusive OR it with the value contained in address 148B. And finally, we store this result into the output register signified by Y. All of this happens again with the new seed values and the second output byte. At the end of this routine, the seed bytes were both ticked twice, and the output bytes were both ticked once. Additionally, the value of A already contains the value of address 148D, so you conveniently don't have to read the value again once the RNG routine is called. After looking at this function for a while, I've come up with a simpler way of thinking about it. We'll call the seed bytes S and T and the output bytes J and K, respectively. Take S, multiply it by 5, add 1, and store that value back into S. Now take T. Look at bits 4 and 7. If they're equal, multiply T by 2 and add 1. Otherwise, just multiply it by 2. Take the exclusive OR of the new values of S and T and put the result into K. Update S and T again using the same method as before. Then take the exclusive OR of the new values of S and T and put the result into J. Then leave value J in the accumulator and return. If you do some analysis, you can find how long until this routine will start repeating output. The value of S is determined by this recursive formula. You can see that S sub 0 equals S sub 256, so after 256 ticks of S, it will repeat. Since S is ticked twice per routine call, S will repeat every 128 routine calls. The value of T is defined by this recursive formula. You can see that T sub 0 equals T sub 217, so after 217 ticks of T, it will repeat. Now since T is ticked twice per routine call, it actually switches parity after one repeat, since the length of the sequence is odd. So T will only repeat every 217 routine calls. The output of the RNG routine is just the exclusive OR of S and T, so we can find when the output repeats by finding the least common multiple of the lengths of the sequences of S and T. The factorization of 128 is 2 to the 7th, and of 217 is 7 times 31. They have no common factors, so the LCM is 27,776. Therefore, the output of Super Mario World's RNG routine will repeat after 27,776 successive calls. And I've verified this by writing a small Java program that emulates this routine and continues calling the RNG until it reaches a repeated value. The RNG routine is available for any function of the game to call. In practice, only sprites call the routine, usually to determine what state they should spawn in or how to behave. Since the RNG values update each time the routine is called, we can tell if some sprite is using RNG if the RNG registers are updating. Each currently loaded sprite may call the RNG routine in its update routine. The sprites are updated in order of sprite slots, starting at slot B and ending at slot 0. Very few sprites actually call the RNG routine often, and most don't even touch it at all. It is also important to know that the 4 RNG bytes are always set to 0 when you exit a level. This means things that call the RNG routine at the start of a level are likely to be consistent, even though they're supposed to be random. For example, the first Dino Torch in this level will always shoot fire upwards, since the RNG value it uses will always be 0.5. Throughout the entirety of the game's code, the RNG routine is only called 53 distinct times, so I've actually documented each call and highlighted exactly how each RNG value is used. There are 3 categories of RNG calls: a call when the sprite is spawning to give it a permanent attribute, a consistent call to provide a continuous sequence of randomness, and a periodic call in response to a particular event occurring. The following sprites tick the RNG at least once when they're initialized. The yellow Koopas use the random number as its initial turnaround timer. They can only turn around every 128 frames when their timer hits 80 and 0. This random value assigned to it allows the Koopas to turn around at different points in time relative to when they were first spawned. See how the different RNG values result in the yellow Paracoopas to turn around at different times, despite Mario's identical movement. Reznor uses the value in a similar way, as it can only shoot fireballs every 256 frames. This means that once you know the pattern of fireballs being shot, you can predict when they'll be shot the next time. The horizontally flying Paracoopas use this value to determine the starting value of the flying timer. When the timer's bit 5 is set, it flies down, otherwise it flies up. Because of this, Paracoopas have an interesting range of flight, and their flight path through this range is dependent on RNG. The Fishbone and Eerie use the random number as its initial animation timer. For whatever reason, the animation cycle in these guys starts differently if the RNG is different. The bonus game uses the value to determine which symbol to put in the center. Interestingly, the star and mushroom both have a 3 out of 8 chance of recurring, but the flower only has a 2 out of 8 chance. The table to determine this is actually 9 bytes long, but only 8 can be read since the index into the table is only 3 bits long. When something lands in lava, lava splash particles are spawned, which each call the RNG routine twice to determine their trajectory and how long they stay on the screen. Similarly, the flame particles that the Potobo give off call the routine once when they spawn to determine their trajectory. The Boo Cloud Ceiling will call the RNG routine for each Boo to determine its starting position on the screen. If we're in the first room of a level, the positions will be consistent since the RNG values are reset when you exit a level. These sprites all tick the RNG at a constant rate. Magikoopa, Her Magic, and Yoshi Wings all call the RNG routine every 4 frames to determine where the sparkles will show up. Similarly, Princess Peach calls it every 8 frames, and the orb uses it every 32 frames for the same purpose. Monty Mole calls the RNG every single frame to determine whether or not to turn and face Mario, even if it already is facing Mario. This results in a chaotic movement pattern, even when Mario is standing still. The candles in Ludwig's room and the fire in Yoshi's house both call the RNG every 4 frames to determine which animation frame to display. The candle flames present in castle backgrounds call the RNG every frame for the same purpose. Spike tops, urchins, hotheads, fuzzies, and sparkies all call the RNG every single frame to determine whether or not to blink. Only the hothead can actually blink, but the other enemies still tick the RNG since they share parts of the code with hothead. Similarly, Fishbone, Bowser, and Peach all call the RNG routine every 128 frames to determine whether or not to blink. The Boo cloud ceiling will call the RNG routine every 8 frames to determine which Boo in the cloud should dive at Mario next. All of these sprites have a complex behavior and call the RNG routine at some point during their behavior cycle. Paragoombas, Potaboes, and Hopping Flames call the RNG after they finish hopping to tell how long until they start hopping again. Hopping Flames, Footballs, and Cheep Cheeps out of water call the RNG to determine how high their next jump will be. Magikoopa calls the RNG routine every time she tries to appear in the level to pick a position on the screen and test whether that is a good spot to stand. When her magic hits a block, it calls the RNG to determine what comes out of the block. Usually the blocks turn into yellow Koopas, but there's a 9 out of 256 chance of it being a Thwimp, 8 out of 256 chance of it being a coin, and a 1 out of 256 chance of being a 1-up. The Fireball, Cheep Cheep, Super Koopa, Bubble, Dolphin, Eerie, and Parachuting Enemy Generators all call the RNG routine to determine where the next enemy will spawn. Charge and Chuck will call the RNG to determine how long he stays in his idle state every time he enters it. The Large Crusher calls the RNG routine every time it crushes to determine where it will be positioned on the screen. The Birds at Yoshi's house call the RNG routine to determine how many times it pecks before moving, the time it takes in between each peck, whether to turn around or not, and how many times it jumps before pecking again. That's a lot of work for something that doesn't have any effect on gameplay at all. Dino Torch calls the RNG to determine whether to shoot fire up or sideways. The Falling Fire in the Bowser fight calls the RNG to determine where the first fireball will show up. And finally, Wendy and Lemmy Koopa call the RNG twice on every cycle to determine which pipes they'll show up in and determine what pose they'll be in. In general, this video showed how the random number generator works using Super Mario World as an example. Other games have their own RNG routines that have different outputs, but the idea is still the same. Remember, RNG is not truly random since it is software-based, which is why it should be called pseudo-RNG. In order to get something truly random, you would need an implementation that is hardware-based. But then, that's just another piece of expensive hardware that can fail, which is probably why a software implementation was chosen instead. Thank you for watching. If you would like to see some of my previous videos, head over to my speedrunning channel, where I uploaded a few more videos about Super Mario World. If you enjoyed what you saw and would like to support the channel and any future videos, consider becoming a patron over at patreon.com/rgmechx. Thank you again for watching.